And like I said, I'll give you about the next 2 to 3 minutes just to set up your chat, to get comfortable, make sure you have a sippy beverage. And, you know, another thing that I think is the best practice we talked about last time is make sure you have a notebook or something to take notes in, because some of the information that Jeremy's going to be sharing or discussing with us today is the type of stuff that I hope you keep with you for the rest of your life. The first time that Jeremy did a presentation for myself and for some of the people that I was with at the time, it was the stuff that changed my life and that I still refer back to during times of challenge. So get your notebook ready to take notes. Another thing that we'd like you to do is if you can announce where you're from in the chat section down in the corner, that's another way to kind of find out where we're at. Last week we had folks from all over the country on our call. And so we just like to find out where you're at. Let's see, what am I missing, Shelly? Is there anything else we wanted to welcome everybody with? Well, let's see, we've got some folks from Sacramento, Roseville in the house, Arroyo Grande, that's where Jeremy's at, Rockland, Auburn up in there, that's right. The Roseville, I am up in Paradise, California. All right, let's hear from you too. Michaela, where are you guys at? Oh, there you go, Citrus Heights. Very, very cool. All right, I'm going to go ahead and switch now so that we have Jeremy as our focus here on our recording. There's an option for you to use speaker view. It's up in the right corner of your screen. If you can go ahead and select that, then I'm going to go ahead and let in our next set of participants. And I'll go ahead and turn it over to Jeremy. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jeremy Bates, the Hope Dealer.
Thanks, Scotty. Oh, yes. Thank you, Serenity. You should clap because isn't Hope in your name? Right? Yeah. Okay. It's so awkward doing these things where you have no real hearing. And I mean, it's nice to see side. I appreciate those of you guys that are turning on your cameras. It's hard in this space to try and engage people when you can't feel like that connection. And I'm sure maybe, especially the kids that are on the call, maybe you had a hard time with that too, learning just that whole idea of shared information when you can't feel the energy that's there. Oh man, that's going to trip me out. What is going on with the blue smoke back there? That's incredible. Woo. Anyway, so understanding this is about comedy and how it fits into us, this idea of sense of humor and everything that's going on in the world right now. We got a lot of stuff lined up. I'll let you know who I am, but just right up front, in the spirit of comedy, if you looked at me and you knew that I was not a speaker, in the chat right now, tell me, and you can be as funny as you want, I got thick skin, what do you think it looks like I do for a living? Have fun, light it up over there, engage. Trust me, I've heard it all, and I'll let you know why this works, but by all means, what do I look like I do? A tattoo artist. A DJ, nice, I can get down with those. You see my drum kit over there and guitars, an artist perhaps. You guys are being nice. Nobody's got a sense of humor out there that wants to really go in hard.
A gym teacher?
Exactly, I get that, a clown. Whoa, wow, that was impressive. Alex, a janitor. Anything else? A radio show host, nice. I've been working on my radio voice. Anything else you guys think about with this? Motivational speaker. I do kind of have that look, maybe. I don't know. Anybody else want to chime in? That might have been a podcaster. See, don't be, that's, this is a brand new mic. Just because I wanted to make it look, I don't even know if it's plugged in, but so I got that one down. Sells protein powder. That's hilarious. A wannabe rapper. That's actually true. That's not even funny. That would be a true statement, but yeah. very cool. Well, I appreciate you guys. That's what I said, vanilla ice. A hypnotherapist. All these are really good. And what I like about it is it's making me laugh, and I can see in your faces it's making you laugh. And one of the things I want to say about comedy is, and if you want to kind of engage in comedy, is you have to have some thick skin. because comedy is about being able to laugh, even at yourself. And the reality is who I know myself to be isn't how people see me. And so I can know who I am to the greatest extent, but if I'm like, I'm this dude that's trying to change the world, I read 7 books a day, but you look at me and you're like, look like a janitor or a DJ. It's like, wow, it's a funny little snapshot, but let me tell you some truths. I start off with this because one of my favorite stories, in a lot of the ways I like to kind of engage audiences, especially really non-traditional ones. I was in Riverside County. I saw that we have somebody from Citrus Heights. I'm not sure if that's the one down south, but I was in front of this court and continuation school. It was actually one that was connected to juvenile hall. And I walked in and I was dressed kind of how I am, in a t-shirt with a watch and some other stuff on. And the very first way I started the presentation was, so tell me what you see in front of you. And these kids lit me up hard. The very first kid raised his hand and he goes, it looks like you're gay. And I said, wow, like what would make you say that? And he goes, well, because look at you wearing that tight shirt and then tight jeans. You look gay. And I said, well, actually, I'm married. I got a couple kids, but that's an interesting one. What else do you see? And this kid raises his hand and he goes, it looks like you've never been robbed. And I said, well, why is that? And he goes, because if you did, you wouldn't come into this room wearing that nice watch. And the irony of that was my house had just gotten robbed about a week and a half prior. And so being able to walk into those spaces and be vulnerable, which is what comedy is, if you're looking at comedians or people that are just kind of putting themselves out through comedy, is our ability to like stand in front of people and give them space to try and see us and know what they're seeing in us, but still know ourselves enough to be like, whatever you see, I still know me. And then the bigger part of that is when you think I'm the guy that's never been robbed or that I identify a certain way, when you're wrong about those things, then I could be like, what else are you wrong about? But if I'm not able to make fun of myself or let you make fun of me, it's hard to have that conversation right up front. So who am I really quickly, just in case you don't know me, my name is Jeremy Bates. I do love music and I create and produce music. So I'm not really a wannabe rapper, but I do kind of dabble in some of that stuff. I am a janitor. I've been a janitor the past 10 weeks because I've been quarantined at home. And I typically travel for a living. And when I have no place to travel, I swear to goodness, my purpose right now is what we call dad's food truck. And it's open until 3 a.m. because I have a college student that's on completely weird times too. So it kitchen closes down at 2, but it's completely closed at 3. What were some other funny ones on there? A podcaster. I've been forced to become a podcaster since all this stuff has happened. By title, I'm an inspirational speaker. By brand, I'm the hope dealer. But in truth, I'm a dad and a husband and somebody that cares a lot about people in the world, even if I don't know them. So that's really who I am. You don't really need to know much because we're already running out of time. If anything, if you have any questions about who I am, I know as young people or even old people, and we're like looking at people, you're like, who are you, fool? Like, if I knew this about you, I feel a little bit better listening. So if there's something that you need to know about me, then go for it and I'll try and answer those things. Part of this whole experience isn't about me being this random dude on a screen. It's like, how do I become as real as possible for you? Okay. So I also want to address really quickly the elephant in the room, which is things are crazy right now and there's heavy realities that are going on. So just so I can kind of get a space of knowing my audience, which is important in comedy, is write one word in the chat that kind of identifies how you feel about the current state of the world. You can think about it for a second, but when you close your eyes and not just about Corona or not just about George Floyd or racism or all the other things that we're thinking about, but just the current state of you right now, what's one word that would describe for me how you're feeling in all of this? And I'll give you a second. And don't feel like you got to be awkward in the silence. Just consider it. And let's see what we got over here. Overwhelmed, uncertain, confused, chaotic, concerned. I appreciate all of you guys kind of chiming in. Torn, sad, overwhelmed. Hopeful and exhausted. Wow. Disturbed, concerned, worried. Okay. Understanding all of that, and aside from the one that was hopeful, and I think even that statement of hopeful comes from like, man, it's so crazy right now. The only way I'm managing is to have that thing. But most of what we're feeling right now are these feelings that we would understand to be these negative emotions, not negative to have them, but the idea that they don't feel good sitting in our bodies. And not only is it, this is how you're feeling, but some of us have been feeling this way for the past 9 or 10 weeks when the whole world's been turned upside down, especially kids in school, people that are worried about their jobs. Like, it's been crazy. And understanding that, it's like, man, what an amazing time for this workshop, because comedy is the one thing that we can use to address these things. It's the one kind of elixir that we can bring into our lives to, even if for a minute, just to make us feel better. When we're swimming in these emotions of concern, overwhelmness, worry, that's our brain just being in this fight or flight mode. And if we look back at like science, there's this idea of toxic stress. And the idea, when you sit in a toxic space for too long and your brain is in fight or flight mode constantly without any place to kind of take a breath, it changes the chemistry of our brain. And so if you've been in poverty the last 20 years and you're always wondering if you're going to be having food on your table or lights on when you come home, like, that changes the way that we operate. And for a lot of people, this is the first time that you've been in fight or flight mode for an extended amount of time, if you've been lucky in life. Some people know this all too well, right? So knowing that, how do we give ourselves space, even in those feelings, to breathe, to laugh, to feel other emotions that let our brain just be like, okay, I don't have to be on this heavy activism role 24/7, maybe 23/7, maybe an hour of funny and then advocacy the rest, I don't know. But the idea is, humor and comedy, it's really our saving grace. And so I wanna talk about that a little bit deeper as we go. When I called Scott a couple days ago, I'm like, yo, I'm supposed to be doing this comedy thing, but I'm really angry right now. And he goes, well, let's talk more about that. And I'm like, I don't wanna come and talk about being all happy, because that in that moment, I'm like, oh, angry. And so we had a great conversation. And when I hung up that call, I went onto Netflix and I watched an hour comedy special. And it just kind of like reshifted everything. And it was like, okay, let me kind of think about how this plays out in my world. So that's what we're going to launch into today. Why comedy? What's important to know? Anybody in here want to be a comedian? Anybody have like any secret desires? Like, nice. I see a smile over here. Who is that? Let me get your name. Jessica, it looked like you smiled, like maybe you got some comedy in you perhaps. Okay. So if you want to be a comedian, there's some things in here to consider. But truthfully, this is just about how do we use comedy in our own lives? And what are those tools that not only help us to survive in the moments, but that we can actually transfer to being funny people the rest of our lives, which are going to help people feel better about themselves too. So the very first thing I got on my list is, why comedy? Brain health. Okay. Let's think about a couple questions of laughter. How many of you guys have ever laughed so hard that your stomach hurt afterwards from laughing? Raise your hand if that's ever been you. Like, you ever laugh so hard your stomach hurt? You ever feel for your six pack afterwards, like it just showed up after that one laughing session? And it's never there, right? It's never there, right? How many of you have ever laughed so hard whatever you drank came shooting out your nose? Happened to you, right? How many of you ever laughed so hard you forgot what you even initially laughing at? Does that ever happen? Like, you've been laughing for so long and somebody like, what's so funny? You're like, I don't even know, man. I've been laughing for too long. Like, you think about that. But I'm going to pause right there, because if we laugh at so long for something, we forgot what we were even initially laughing at in the beginning. And maybe if we laugh so long at something, we can forget about those negative feelings for a moment and allow us to kind of start addressing the things that we want to address, not out of anger or frustration, but with a clear mind and with a healthier brain. How many of you ever laughed so hard that you were laughing at stuff that wasn't even funny afterward just because you were on a laughing roll? That ever happened to you? Right? Or my favorite, how many of you have ever laughed so hard you almost peed your pants from laughing? Right? That's always one of my favorites, because that's when it gets real, real fast, right? When you're in that moment and everybody's kind of laughing, you're like, hold up, stop, like, stop, I'm gonna pee, right? It goes from laughter to very serious, right? But here's your honesty question, and that is, how many of you have actually laughed so hard you actually peed your pants? So I'm gonna give you a little second before we get, yeah, okay, cool. Young people, no, okay, there we go. See, it always takes a little bit of awkward, like, yeah. If we could think about that moment of those of you that did pee your pants while you were laughing, there's this concept through the brain science that the first most natural thing that we can do to release this endorphin that makes our brain feel good, serotonin, dopamine, all that stuff, the first most natural thing we could do is hug people. But that's weird. People are like, I ain't hugging nobody. And especially now, you can't hug people because of corona, 6 feet, safe distance, right? So since we can't hug anymore, the second most natural way we can release that endorphin that changes our brain is to laugh. And there's that concept that says laughter can take something that's tragic in one sense and turn it to something that's okay in another. Comedy has that power. And if you don't believe it, think about those of you that peed your pants while you were laughing, right? When that goes down, typically we start laughing even harder when we start peeing, because you can't believe that you're laughing and peeing and it's all okay. And that's because laughter is built into the situation. If we take laughter out of those moments and we start going through life, like if somebody was just randomly peeing themselves next to you at some in the Starbucks or wherever, it wouldn't be funny. It would be really awkward, right? Am I the only one that would think that? Or I don't know, maybe we're more, I don't know. Okay, yeah, laughter can change the way you feel. So this concept of us when we're in these moments of struggle and feeling overwhelmed and uncertain and worried and just like the end of the world is coming, that ability to laugh allows us to give our brain space to be able to work the way that it should. The other thing to consider is, how do we make other people laugh? One of my friends, her name was, this one's always tough to tell, right? Her name was Jody, and Jody had breast cancer. And the first time that she got it, she went through treatment. They thought it was in remission. It was supposed to be all good. But then the cancer came back, and it wasn't going to be able to be dealt with. It was too big at the time, and everybody in her family and in our community knew what was going down. And it got to the spot where she was just like waking up in emotion heavy every day, and her kids, her young kids, crying every day because they know the outcome of what's to happen. And Jody in those moments was like, I got to do something different. And so she came up with this thing called the Laughter List. And her thing was, I want to do something that's going to make my kids and other people laugh every day to deal with what I'm currently dealing with. So she created this really cool list of stuff to do. The first thing that was on that list was the ice cream truck. She wanted to contact our local ice cream truck dude and get all the ice cream donated and just travel around the neighborhood with her kids in the ice cream truck handing out ice cream to kids just to see people smile and also to teach her kids that the best gift that you can give is one that you don't have to expect something back in return for. Once that got onto the news here, and that was in Cayucas, once that got onto the news, it picked up nationally. Another dream that she had on that list was she wanted to be on the Ellen Show. She wanted to meet President Barack Obama. And everything started to happen based on that act of her being in that ice cream truck. Somebody found out about it, sent it to Ellen. Ellen brought her onto the show. Ellen introduced her to President Barack Obama, and her list was just like bap, 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 all the way down. All because even in the heaviest moment with death on the horizon, it was like, this is what we're dealing with. But in truth, the only way that we can keep waking up every day and not swim that negative emotion is to have humor on our mind in the forefront and make some intentful choices that will allow us to go out and inspire people along in that process to remind them the importance of laughter and humor too. Okay. As I continue on, the next thing for you on the side is, tell me something about your life that's funny or it's been fun or funny. You could think about it for a second. I'm going to keep going on, but if you're on the side, is there something in your world, in your life, that you would consider that happened that was fun or funny? Okay. Because here's the deal, as you're thinking about that and you're listening and typing, the next thing I have on my list, not just is the health. Okay, thank you. I appreciate that, Christina. Trauma. I don't want to ask you to raise your hand and be like, how many of you have dealt with trauma in life or are currently dealing with trauma? But for me, my skill in comedy and for me to be sitting here in front of you is based on being this dude that loves to make people laugh. If you know about me, you know I come from this environment where there was a lot of drugs, there was a lot of divorce, there was a lot of uncertainty. I mean, I was swimming in a lot of mess, right? And when my mom and dad split up at 2 and I was living with my mom and watching her and her addiction just get bigger and bigger, my mom would disappear for chunks of time at a time. And for me as a kid, I remember specifically realizing like how it made people feel when I made them laugh, especially in craziness. So if my mom was gone for some amount of time and she came back, I didn't want to judge where she had been. I just wanted to make her feel better that she was there. And I wanted to make myself feel better. And so I just became this joke guy. And it wasn't about like having like one-liner jokes. It was like, how do I just through my own conversation and personality develop this thing that allows me to not just diffuse situations that start to elevate, but also allow me to not get too crazy in my own brain to realize what my truths are. Because when I swim in that space, even still at 46, I'm like, dang, this is really a lot. This is heavy for somebody to deal with. my son Justice was diagnosed with epilepsy about 2.5 years ago. And he's a funny guy too. And so when we think about the traumas that we have, when he was diagnosed with epilepsy, it shook our whole family, and rightly so, because our whole world changed. And when he lost all the stuff that he had loved, you know, we live on the beach, so he can't be in the water anymore. He can't climb trees because if he's a, he can't be in the water because if you have a seizure and you're in the water, you can potentially drown. You can't climb a tree because if you're in a tree and you're a fall, you know, risk, and you have a seizure in a tree, you could potentially die. So it's like all the stuff that has anything where if something bad happens, death happens, he loses. So he launches all into his guitar, and he's about ready to play in a school talent show. I think he was in fourth grade or fifth, and he was going to play Blackbird by the Beatles, and it's a finger picking song. It's incredibly difficult, and he had been just putting in work, and I was so excited for him. I'm like, dude, you're going to crush this. And 2 days before the talent show, when they're doing a sound check at the big auditorium, they're doing it, he comes home and he goes, Dad, I don't think I'm going to do that anymore. And I said, why, bud? He said, because I don't feel that's my talent. And I said, well, what are you going to do? And he goes, I'm going to show him my real talent. And I said, well, what's that? And he just started like freaking out like he was having a seizure. And I'm like, dude, that hurts my heart. Like, do you know, as a dad, like, I don't even like to see your body do that. But for him, in his mind, the kid that's dealing with it, even at a different level than I was, like his whole thing was like, dude, I won't make this funny. He wasn't going to give up his guitar. He still went out and slayed Blackbird. But even in that conversation, which is like, Dad, calm down. I know you worry about this. Like, why don't you see it like I see it, which is it's funny. So if you are dealing with trauma or you're dealing with heavy situations, that ability to laugh saves you in those. It doesn't just help with the brain science. It helps keep you alive because of your perspective. Okay. Trying to read these stories over here. Resilience, clutter. We're going to talk about funny. I'll get to those. I appreciate you guys chiming in. And the cool part is this is going to be captured too, right, Scott? I'm assuming in the recording, so we'll be able to see these for a little bit longer. Nope. Okay, never mind then. It was going to be cool. Last thing I want to talk to you about with comedy is not just the brain health. It's not just about how it helps us deal with trauma, but it's also a conversation tool. Any of you guys ever deal with really emotional people? Any of you guys live with emotional people? Anybody? And you can raise your hand if it's you, because I'm that emotional person. Okay. Or you work with people that sometimes you're supposed to be all chill and they come all in emotional and you're like, oh, like, idle down. Right? In basic training. You would probably have to laugh through basic training, right? It's like the only thing that keeps you alive. Okay. Oh, Madison. Oh my gosh, Madison. Are you still a basic trainer? Are you back home? Are you back in the valley? Sorry. I just see people I know. This is amazing. I forget who I'm with right here. I'm Colorado. Congratulations. Stay safe out there, sweet lady. Okay. Back to us. When we're in those spots, comedy is one of the two things I think of. It diffuses situations, and it's a tool that you can use to get people to think that's not so abrasive. Because when you wrap things in comedy, it becomes somehow okay. Or at least that's what I think, because sometimes my wife's like, I know you think you're being funny by saying that, but that's not funny to me. But I'm like, it's comedy. It's meant to be funny. So I get the difference. But diffuse. For me as a kid, anytime people would want to fight me, I just start making them laugh. I forget they were even mad or wanted to fight me. I just try to be like, how do I show you this is silly or stupid or whatever. Situations with other adults when stuff's going down. I always try and find comedy to be the middle ground to bring people down to, but also to be the conversation starter. So just for fun, and to get a little bit of not me on the screen, is Scotty, will you get that video queued up? One of the most amazing videos that I've seen in the last couple weeks is this guy, Michael Che, that addresses this idea of Black Lives Matter through comedy. So we're going to play it real quick. It's a couple minute clip. And a couple things I want to get you to understand. When you're watching comedy, if you become viscerally angry, then it probably applies to you. If you're like, man, I can't believe that I don't feel that way, it's not for you to say that other people don't feel that way. It's not for you to project your feelings. It's like, that's that person's perspective. I actually watch every comedian I can find on Netflix, and I sit through stuff I can't stand and things I don't even agree with or their version of comedy. But what it does, it allows me a little insight into their perspective of truth. Okay? So real quick, Scotty, press play, enjoy Michael Che, and we'll come back in a second.
We can't agree on anything anymore. as a country. We just can't agree. We just fight about everything. We can't even agree on Black Lives Matter. That's a controversial statement. Black lives matter. Not matters more than you, just matters. Matters. Just matters. That's where we're starting the negotiations. Matters. We can't agree on that shit. What the fuck is less than matters? Black lives exist. Can we say that? Can we say, is that controversial? We always ask for the lowest common denominator. We ask for the lowest rights. Gays were fighting for equal rights. Equal rights. That's, could you believe that's an actual stance you can have? You could be for equal rights. That means there's people out there saying, I think everybody should have the same rights as everyone else. And there's other people like, nah, son, I disagree. I just don't think so. Black people was fighting for civil rights, not even equal. Just civil. Can we get civil? Can we get, I'll take civil rights. Just be civil. Want civil. Can we get civil? Turn the fucking hose off. Can we just get... They don't tell you black lives don't matter. That's not what they say. That's not the argument. They hit you with that slick shit. Like, well, all lives matter. Really? Semantics? That would be like if your wife came up to you and was like, do you love me? And you were like, baby, I love everybody. What are you talking about? God's creatures. What are you saying? You're no different. Why do black people always have to get over shit so quickly? Thanks, black lady. Right? Why do we always gotta get over shit? Every time we bring some shit up. Slavery. Oh, that was 400 years ago. Segregation. Oh, well, you guys got Black History Month out of it. Come on, we gave you February. Police shooting, that was 2 weeks. Come on, you still? 9/11, oh, never forget. That's why this September, I'm getting a t-shirt that says, all buildings matter. Let me see how that works. No? You want one?
You're back, Jeremy. Let me unmute you.
Okay. So first of all, the one thing I want to apologize for is language. I forgot that I had language in it. But at the same time, it's like catching like, oh, we got young people. I'm sure it's not the first time that these people have heard that word. And it's the same thing with my kids and language. I'm like, if what you're hearing is the word and you're bitter about that, then we're missing the bigger message behind. And whether you agree with that stuff or not, it's not for us to debate right here. It's just the idea that how do we, as a person like that, that feels that situation, how do they use that gift to try and start the conversation? Because as we know, if you're just trying to have the conversation, some people are too aggressive to want to even engage in it because there's a lot of ego attached, okay? So just a fun way to kind of show perspective, how we get into that conversation, but also use it to diffuse too. So next thing is the contents of funny. Real quickly in the chat line, what makes something funny to you? Like what, when I say something's funny, what makes you laugh? When you're watching something, when you're around with people, what's funny to you? What makes something funny? Unexpected. I have sick humor. Me too. Humility. Ooh. You don't want to know. Statement. That's a funny statement. Trust me, irony, okay. Fart jokes, they never. Bad dad jokes. I got a dad joke, you want a dad joke? I don't know if you know how some people call like people my age, like I got a dad bod, right? You're like, no, this ain't a dad bod. This is called a father figure. Woo! Oh, sarcasm. What else we got over here? What's going on? Something authentic. Cool. What's funniest thing I heard all day? I'm sorry, because that's bad. That's the funniest thing you heard. We need to hang out more. Okay, I'm just waiting for that list to stop. See, and Alex, you said that you didn't want to know, or that your humor was too sick, but that was actually pretty fun. Cheesy pickup lines. Things that make people cringe a little, right? Are you tired? Are you asking me that? Do I look tired, Serenity? Oh, make a serious topic lighter. Absolutely. Hey, you guys are nailing all these on the head, all of them. And the cool part is, again, they're not right or wrong answers, because you've been running through my mind all day. Oh, gotcha, that one. Yeah, right. I was like, are you telling me I'm tired? But you were setting up the line, okay? Which shows us comedy's hard when the other person can't hear. There is no right or wrong answer. And this, so it's good to know what people think is funny. But all that stuff over there, there are things that are that need to be laughed at. Would you agree? Irony, things that make you feel uncomfortable. Fart jokes, like, you know, it's how it's supposed to shake down. I have on my list, I came up with three things to kind of encapsulate it. The first one is that they're true, that there's some sort of truth to it. And maybe the more true the statement and the less that people talk about it, the more funny it is for those people that have courage to bring it up and address it, right? There's that idea of like, oh my God, I can't believe that he said that. That's really funny, okay? Another thing that one of you guys identified was the idea of it's uncomfortable. Like some of the things that are funny are like maybe even uncomfortable to a certain point. And maybe that's why it's funny, is because it's our defense mechanism of like, but it's still funny, right? And then the other thing I have on there is personal. And I think somebody put it on our chat log, which is authentic. Is this something that has some personal nature to it, where people are being vulnerable? And sharing portions of about themselves, even if they're mocking themselves or having a good sense of humor about who they are, okay? I also have two other words on here about remaining funny. Grandmother, nice. Christina, that's amazing. Fart jokes at funerals, what they will always kill. See what I did there? That was a joke. It's hard. Anyway. Humility. I have humility on my list of contents of funny, because you have to be humble. You can't take yourself too seriously. How many of you guys have ever been wrong? Just to make sure I'm cool. I always like to tell people, like, if I had a dollar for every time I was wrong, I would be $5 richer. That's funny. I wrote that one this morning for you guys. I want to make sure I had some good stuff in the can, just in case, you know. I didn't want to like just leave it to coming off the cuff. So humility is important. You have to be humble. Assumptions are also kind of problematic, right? What do they say about assuming? Somebody tell me what they say about assuming. What do we say about assuming? Assuming. Somebody write in the text. What? Assuming. What do we know about assuming? Help me out here. Makes a thing out of you and me. No. Assuming means pretty much I'm right most of the time. That's what I tell my kids. You know what they say about assuming? Then the dad's always right. That's what you should assume. When we're trying to be funny, one of the assumptions that we don't want to make is that everybody's a comedian. One of the best environments that we can put ourselves in when you're a funny person is to be around other funny people. Because when you're around two comedic people, nothing is off limits. Nothing. But if you're around somebody that's not a comedian and you're trying to go to places that are off limits to other people, it's going to be very offensive. So just be careful. And part of that is also to stay humble and curious of like, hey, are you funny? Do you like jokes? I know when Scotty and I get together, we go hard. And we say jokes that most people would be like, wow, it's jokes that we probably can't even say. No, we couldn't. But it doesn't mean that people don't think it. It doesn't mean that it's not funny to us, but we would be very aware of who our audience was around that. Another quick question for you on the side, which is, what's the difference between fun and funny? If I asked you to consider the difference between the two, something that's fun versus something that is funny, what would you identify as the difference? Anybody think of this? Yeah, me and Scotty do get going. Difference between fun and funny? Anybody want to try and throw that in the chat box? Or you could even put raise your hand and you could address us. Funny is a reaction. Fun is swimming. Funny is slipping and falling on your butt without getting hurt. Humor versus happy times. Funny could be morbid, but you laugh. Fun is experimental. Any others? Anybody else want to chime in? No? Fun is an action. Funny is an emotion. Interesting. Lyndon, where is Lyndon? I got Lyndon on my list. I don't even see it. Oh, Lyndon, they're all good, but for me, I'm like, dang, that's the dart right there, right? Because one of the things that we want to talk about is we want to encourage fun is doing, funny is a perception experience where funny is just temporary. Okay, you guys are all getting it, right? The idea is if I'm here promoting comedy and this idea of making people laugh, we also want to acknowledge that we make people laugh in the space of something that's fun. Typically, something that's funny is done at somebody's expense. That's the emotional feeling. That's what makes it funny is it's on somebody, right? If you're watching wreck videos, like one of the most watched things on YouTube are just wreck videos, people crashing, just wrecking. And that's funny. Like, I'll laugh at that. Why? Because it's at somebody else's expense. I think it would take me probably a couple years if any of those things really happened to me that I'd be able to look at the video and laugh. Probably the first 5 years I'd have PTSD, be like, don't even show me that, right? I can remember being in eighth grade. I was like 4'3" in middle school. I was the point guard. And so part of being the point guard was I got to be the kid in the front of the basketball line, you know, when we come out for warmups. And so being the little guy, the point guard, I had the ball in my hand and I'm like, this is amazing. I'm an eighth grader. I get to bring the team out onto the court. So I come running. And the cheerleaders are holding their little sign that says LOMS, eighth grade basketball. And I'm the first one with the ball. But they didn't do the cool stuff they do now where they kind of cut holes in the butcher paper. That's like a new thing back in the mid 80s. We just kept it gangster straight across. And me being the little kid with the ball, I really wasn't that strong either. And I kind of wasn't prepared for what I was going up against. So I ran and I thought I was going to burst through the paper, but the paper knocked the ball out of my hand, which I then stepped on, which I then came tumbling through the paper. And the line stopped, and the whole middle school gymnasium is laughing. Now, was that funny? Absolutely. To them, they were all laughing, and rightly so. Like, that was a great thing to watch. I'm sure it was. I wish there was a video of it. Was it fun for me? No, not in the slightest. I can joke about it now, but if I really, like, put my mind space there, I can still feel that feeling of just being so ashamed and also because I was already made fun of for being small, it's like, here's the proof that it's just little germ, okay? Be careful when we're trying to be fun with people, having fun, making them laugh, that we're not doing it at people's expense, unless you're willing to be the one that it's the expense of first, or to check in with people to know who your audience is, okay? I would probably venture to say when I open this whole thing up and I let you make fun of me in the beginning, that as we continue on with this relationship, you're like, oh, okay, this is probably something. I could probably make fun of you if we're in this relationship that way, right? If we're not, or if it's not funny all the time, adults that are in here, like, you ever had a boss that was just mean all the time? That kind of boss is almost easier to deal with the one that you're like, are you mean today or are you nice today? Are you going to be mean when I say this? Are you going to be nice, right? So consistency, even in our humor, is important as well. Oh, what about time-wise, Scott? So let's got another one. We're good. We got 20 minutes in. I want to play one more video for you for fun. Scotty, let's start this one. Do you have the text that I sent you with the time? I'll get it up because we're running out of time and I don't want to go in on this. But what I do like about this is it's a 14-year-old kid. Start it from the 235 mark, if you would, Scotty. Just a quick backstory. When I was putting this together, I was trying to find some comedy to use. And this kid, I remember hearing him a couple years ago. He's 14 years old. And the comedy is hilarious, but I also wanted to inspire kids that are on here to not just show you people like Michael Che or like famous comedians, but to understand that young people have a mind and a voice. And when they can use it right, can say some pretty incredible things too. So, Scotty, roll this real quick and we'll talk about it in a second. What was somebody not kind and didn't rewind, or what? What do you got going on over there, bud?
School experience, which is full of bullying, clicks, and gossip.
35. There you go.
Are you enjoying yourself, sir? Are you having a good time? What's your name?
Tim.
Tim, do you know what I have to do when I get home, Tim? Write a paper for school. I'm going to my first year of high school. I'm hoping it'll be different than my middle school experience, which is full of bullying, cliques, and gossip, mostly from the teachers.
That's sad.
The teachers are no better than the students, maybe even worse. They always act like NFL coaches on the sidelines, using folders to cover their mouths as they talk crap about the students. Wow. Yo, see Patty over there? That little kiss ass reminded me that I forgot to sign the homework yesterday as I was about to dismiss the class. So I doubled it. The hell is her problem? Oh my God, and Kyle, I don't know what I was doing in your class, but in mine, he is just bombing. I wanna fail him, you know, just smack him in the face with a big fat F. But then I'll have to put up with his crap for a whole nother year. Oh, Spencer, nice kid, but his parents, ugh. I keep getting 8-paragraph emails from them telling him I'm not giving him the credit he deserves. Well, maybe if his parents had stopped telling him he's good at everything, he wouldn't cry like a little bitch every time I gave him a B-. What are you looking at, Kyle? Get back to work. Dioramas don't make themselves. The lunchroom is known for its notorious bullying. You know, the big guys always shoving their way to the front of the line, taking the last smoothie from you, so they can go back to grading papers. You know what grinds my gears, Tim? Tests. I do not like tests. I'm not very good at studying. I'm not what you would call an academic test taker. I'm not sure why. I usually give myself a full 5 minutes to study before the test. Thank you. That's not my fault, though. It's the teacher's fault. They always tell you, challenge yourself. So I challenge myself to see how long I can put off studying. Challenge accepted. I know, I'm probably not as responsible as Tim here, who never procrastinates. Because adults don't do that. Right, Tim? All right, thank you guys. Before I leave, since parting is such sweet sorrow, I'd like to give you a little snippet from my favorite author, Willie Shakespeare. Don't you forget about me. Don't you forget about me as I walk on by. Thank you.
What about the 14-year-old throwing it, right? My back muted, Scotty. Unmute me. Am I muted? How come I can't hear? Okay, we're good. So you can hear back me. Perfect. So again, we could talk about that and the whole idea of like a fun way to talk about bullies. I like to use that every now and again at staff developments, especially with teachers, because it's an uncomfortable reminder for them that sometimes they might be part of the problem. You know, it's like, hey, how do we increase school spirit on school campuses? And it's like, how about some of you change your behaviors? Because kids pick up on it. Now, are all teachers that way? No. But is there some truth in it? And if you can't hear that truth enough to want to kind of reflect back on yourself and your own actions, then you're missing the point of comedy and you're missing the point of life, to be quite honest. And again, when he dropped the B word in there, that's not coming from him. That's from the perspective of how he hears adults talking to other adults about kids. So I know it makes you cringe a little bit, but part of it is we need to cringe because it's that reminder of a truth. Most things that affect us in some way, you're like, oh, it doesn't feel right. But understand where it comes from. Hey, 15 minutes on the clock. I'm going to try and get to these two last things. I like to hear a young dude poking fun at his superiors. Absolutely. Okay. What's hope got to do with it? What has hope got to do with comedy or being a comedian or anything? Really quickly, if you haven't been around me in the last year or so, I've been really trying to focus people's attention away from hope being this feeling or an emotion, but trying to teach people that hope is actually a verb that's got action to it. And if you can imagine a triangle, at the top of that triangle is a goal that you want to achieve. And that's like the dream, right? Like everybody's got a dream. I got a dream of wanting to be a comedian. So I put that at the top. But the problem is a dream is this kind of fantasy that's like just out there floating. So if we can make it a goal and put it at the top of our triangle, then it's like achievable. And there's this idea that says what can be measured can be managed. And so when you could put goals up on top of that thing that you can measure your work towards, it's going to be easier to manage than just being like, I want to be a comedian. I don't even know what that means. But if I can create some goals to help me get there, I can manage that process. Okay. So at the top of the triangle, we have this thing called goals. And then on two sides of it, we have way power and willpower. And what that means is, do we know the things that it's going to take to get what it is that we say we want? And on the other side is the will, which is, do we have the courage to be committed to do those things every day, as well as having supports around us that when our willpower depletes, that other people are reminding us of the good stuff that we're supposed to be doing. Students, you're out there. How many of you, when you're at home, social distancing, you're like, okay, I'm all in. And you're all trying to have willpower to block out the stuff around you to stay focused. And it starts off good at 9 o'clock in the morning, or maybe one, if that's your new schedule that you get up around noon and eat breakfast and then go on. But see, you laugh. That means it's true. Y'all got new bedtime song. Who's going to bed no earlier than 2 a.m. right now? 2 a.m. people, where are you at? No, just me? Okay, whatever. We're still not being honest. Right here. Thank you, Madison. See, Amelia busted. See, come on. It's about being vulnerable, people. But the willpower, when you're that person and you are exerting your willpower, it's like a energy level in a game that starts to deplete. It's actually your willpower stored in your glucose system. And you don't just get to eat a Snicker bar and restore your sugar glucose. You have to have people around you to remind you that when your willpower is depleted, that you're still supposed to be working. That's why people that are in addiction, that's why 12-step programs, it's so hard to do on your own. It's not impossible. But the idea is, when it's gone, who's going to help you out? And I know for a lot of what I've been feeling these last 10 weeks, when I haven't been able to see my friends, I haven't been able to do my work, I haven't had some of those supports around me, it's really easy to get off routine, to gain 10 pounds, to lose sight of what my dreams were, as the world is now in a completely different place. Okay? So we start by having a goal at the top, understanding that there's a way to get there and the will. So if we think about comedy real fast, if you wanted to be a comedian and you put comedian at the very top of the list, you can put in the chats over here, what are some things that you think that you would need to do in order to get there? What are the ways to become a comedian? Does anybody know? Write a couple things over there if you can understand. Perfect. Write jokes. It's number 3 on my list. You have to actually write. Like, this isn't just about being funny. Like, hey, I'm really funny. But you got to be up on stage and you got to have 3 minutes of content, which means you have to write jokes. And the more that you write, the better that you will get. Brainstorm and practice. Improv. Be vulnerable. Be confident in your own jokes. We're going to talk about that. Commit to performing. You got to perform, right? You have to get on stage. You have to be able to get up in those spaces. But some people are like, I want to be a comedian, but I'm afraid of being in front of people. I want to be a comedian, but I've never even actually tried to make somebody laugh in my own family. Okay. Commit to your jokes. Public speaking. Absolutely. People always say public speaking, like, you're such a good public speaker. Do you know how you get to be a good public speaker? You speak in front of people. Nobody's a good public speaker in the beginning. We all started off with the same language, the same like rate of speed of speech and understanding of language. It's just the more that we do this, the more better we get. I'll give you a specific example. When I'm in other states doing programs, well, back when I actually got to fly places and work, sometimes if my program is 8 o'clock in the morning, the very first people I speak to are the words that matter most when I'm on stage. And you're like, this isn't good. So I got to find people that I could call at 5 o'clock in the morning just to get some words out to practice speaking before I go get on stage when my words matter the most. Hey, anything else on this list over here? Serenity, somebody's giving you love. Hey, a couple things I have on my list that you didn't identify. You have writing, vulnerability, and performing. Two things. Number one is accumulate life experiences that can be funny. Part of being a comedian is having life experiences that you can draw on. There are observational comedians like the Jerry Seinfelds that just make observations and talk about that. Like, so if you had, what's the deal with these people? You know, those comedians, like, that's observational. But this is not about the observation of other people. This is about you having life experiences that you can make fun of or that you could talk about to get other people to laugh about the truth that you know. Right? I'll give you a quick example real fast. I have time. So when my son got epilepsy, he started having seizures in his bedroom that we didn't even know about, which was scary because we're like, we'll just manage it from home. But then he had a seizure in his room that he was completely out for an hour. He came back downstairs and had like just marks all over his face. His glasses were an issue. It was bad news. So we get Nest cameras because he can't be in his room on his own anymore. And I'll just tell you that you don't always want to see everything that your 13-year-old does in their bedroom all the time. But we need Nest cameras, okay? Now, just a sidebar is I'm married, and me and my wife are very different. And I say that with the biggest heart, but we're just different. Like, my wife is very linear. She's very structured. Like, the reason why our family is successful as we are is because of my wife. But the reason why we're funny is because of me. And so sometimes our ways of conversing don't always work, especially when we're in conversations. You guys might call them arguments, but semantically that's on you, right? So we get into these conversations. And now the good part for me is I have an autographic memory, which means I could hear something and commit it to memory, and I'll tell you what you just said. It's a gift. And she has this gift where sometimes she says things and a couple minutes later she says something different and then forgets that she said the first thing. That's a gift too, if we look at it that way. Right? So we got into a conversation once in the kitchen and it started getting heated. And I was like, no, that's not what she said. She goes, yes, it is. I said, no, it's not. And she said, yes, it is. And then I realized, hold up, Nest cameras just don't capture video. They capture audio. And we got them in every room. So I kindly apologized. You're right. I'm sorry. My bad. I ran upstairs. I'm ashamed to tell you how fast I ran up my stairs to go prove my wife wrong. I was like, I don't want a gold medal. I ran up there so fast. I get out my laptop. I open it up. I'm going through the Nest footage just to see when I come into frame into the kitchen, and then I see it. I press play, and I'm like, I was ready to call down for some popcorn and be like, yo, because I just about to be good. And I see the conversation go down, and I'm listening to it. And as I'm about to crush my wife, you know what I saw? I saw me. I saw myself in that conversation for the first time. I saw the way I was standing over my wife, posturing over her in a way that was shameful. I heard the words that were coming out of my mouth in a tone that is not how I hear it in my head. I use my speaker tone, my podcast voice. Baby, what's wrong with you today? But that's not how it came out. So in that moment when I wanted to crush my wife, I had to go down and apologize, literally with tears in my eyes. And she's like, what's wrong with you now? And I'm like, I'm sorry, I'm ready to crush you, but this is on me. See, even in that, if I can tell you that story and some of you are laughing through, that's how I can use comedy in my own life experience to teach you about what are you doing in life that if you could see yourself from a distance, would you want to change? And how many of you are actively looking for the Nest camera to see those things? Because most of us wouldn't want to look. But if we're going to be better at life, we have to. And part of us looking is not holding ourselves to this heavy accountability like, oh my God, I messed up. It's about realizing that we're human and learning from it. And the more that I tell that story in a funny way is the more people in the world are like, damn, I'm not the only ass that talks to my wife that way. My wife would be like, you're a public speaker. You go around teaching the whole world how to communicate. How you doing now, Mr. Public Speaker? And I'd be like, damn. She's also a marriage and family therapist, but I'm like, you would never say that to one of your clients. But then we just go round and round, nothing changes. Okay. Consider for that accumulating life experience. The other thing I will say is to have a lucid reality of knowledge. And that means you can't have a skewed perspective of life. You have to have a true lucid knowledge, a working knowledge of people, of places, of culture, because otherwise you come off as tone deaf. So be seekers of information that are constantly trying to find more. Okay. I have on my list feedback and failure. You can't be a comedian if you're not down with people heckling you, giving you feedback, and failing. And I think that's just important in life in general, too. We take ourselves way too seriously, and a lot of us won't even ask for feedback. But if you want to be a good comedian, you better get feedback after every program, after every show, and then you throw those jokes away, and you put in new stuff that actually land with people. Because the point isn't to waste people's time. The point is not to waste our lives. It's about being effective with the time that we have and make sure the words that we're saying that we want to land on people's hearts, that they're landing the way that they do. And the only way that happens, not just with our words, with our actions, is to get some feedback. If you're in a relationship, it's like, hey, I'm trying to love you. How am I doing? How many of you said that to your spouse or significant other today when you woke up? Hey, how did I do yesterday? Scotty. This guy. Right? And it's not about passing judgment. It's just about catching ourselves enough to be like, are we those people that really want to know? Do we have thick enough skin? Okay. I got one last thing to get through real quick. And this is kind of what some of you put over here on the side, which is about confidence and practice. Stage time is my last heading. And I have three things I want to talk about. Nerves, confidence, and courage. I had on my list here, if we had time, but I don't have time, but you could type it actually if you want, is what are things that bring out nerves in you? Like if you're in some place in life, what makes you nervous? And as you're thinking about that, and you almost can even viscerally feel the nervousness in you right now, is then think about why do you get nervous about it? And we start to learn that nerves are a good thing. When we're feeling nervous, it means that we care about what it is that we're about to do. If you're not nervous and you don't care, then it's a sign that it's not even worth it to you. Maybe it's not even investing. But when you feel nervous, it's like, man, there's a lot on the line. As a parent, this first couple weeks of parenthood, you're like, oh my God, like I could ruin this thing forever. There's a nervousness in that because it means you care. So don't run from places that feel nervous to you. Step into them, acknowledge the feeling, and then be like, wow, this is nervous because it matters, and celebrate that it matters. One of my craziest stories was working with the military. I was working with the USS Eisenhower on the East Coast, and they brought them all from the aircraft carrier into the Virginia Beach Convention Center. And so I had 5,000 people in one room, and it wasn't a frilly room. It was literally a convention center, military style, which is, it had nothing in it but 5,000 seats, which meant sounds echoing and bouncing all over the place. I show up there after having slept for 45 minutes the night before because I was so worked up and nervous about being good. So knowing I was tired, on my way to the convention center, I stopped at the convenience store and I grabbed a Monster energy drink and I grabbed a 5-hour energy. And I'm like, bap, bap, I'm coming in wired. Like I gotta be alive. I get in there, I sound check, and I start to realize that the sound's bouncing everywhere and I loop things. And so it's hard to loop when sounds bounce. And I'm like, this is gonna just bomb. And my nerves started getting the best of me. So after the first speaker's up, I check in, I set up my gear on stage. I ask the commander, how much time do I have? He goes, you got about 10 minutes. I'm like, cool, because I need to go to the bathroom. Because my stomach at this point in time was literally in all of the knots of all the knots. And as I want to go to the bathroom, there's also 5,000 sailors that are also trying to use the restroom. And I also don't want to be the presenter that goes to the bathroom as my stomach's all crazy with the people I'm supposed to be presenting for, because I'm supposed to be different, right? I'm not real. I'm just the dude on the stage. So I go find a bathroom in the very back of the convention hall, taking care of myself, feeling a little bit better. Okay, cool. I start walking towards the convention center and I hear the dude on the mic going, where is he? I know he's around here someplace. And I'm like, yo, they started early. And so here I am now in the most nervous part of my life, and I'm not even on stage when I'm supposed to be on stage. If you can be like, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Jeremy Bates. And then like, and so I had to get on stage and then been like, I could either lie about this or I could be real. So I'm like, yo, I'm freaked out right now. And that little bit of understanding and that nerves and acknowledging it was a great place to start. Okay? The other two words to talk to you about really quickly, and I wish I had some more time, but I just want to be respectful of the 4 o'clock time, is confidence versus courage. And if you can think about the difference of those two, they're very different. And first thing I'll say is don't ever shoot down either when you're around people. If you see somebody that's overconfident, it's not your job to tell them they're not. If you're seeing somebody that's being courageous, don't tell them that what they did wasn't courageous, that it was really silly and you did that when you were 4. Just keep stoking confidence and courage in people. And they'll figure it out themselves, okay? Confidence is brought up by you doing things multiple times. Confidence is created by comfort, and comfort is only created by mastering something. I am incredibly confident when I get on stage. I'm nervous because it matters, but I'm confident because I have done this for the last 12 years professionally. I've been in front of all kinds of audiences. Like, I know what I'm doing. I know how to do it. And so therefore, that confidence in me, it comes out. And the crazy part is you don't just get to like pull up confidence, and it's never really there when you need it if you haven't practiced it. Think about sports. You can't be confident in doing something on an athletic field if you haven't done it over and over and over again to when it's all going down that it just reverts into natural state and you're like, I got this. This is confidence. You think of the places that you're most confident in your life, it's probably the places that you put in the most time into that thing, and that's why you're confident in it. Where confidence isn't allowed, that's when courage takes over. And you have to have both these to be a comedian. Courage isn't, it's not this fandangle thing, it's just you have this courage to step into that place not knowing what the outcome is going to be. Now, how do you cultivate confidence? If I asked you, how do you raise a confident kid, you'd come up with a whole list of things, okay? But personally, one of the greatest things I've ever learned is if you want to build confidence in yourself is make promises to yourself every day, small promises, and stick to them. And the more that you stick to them, then you start building into yourself. Like, well, I've said that I wanted to run 4 miles every day. I've done that for the last 3 years. So when I make a promise to myself, I know I'm going to come through with it. So I'm like, hey, I'm going to show up. I won't be good. I know this because every time I say that to myself, I show up and I don't let myself down. How do we cultivate courage? You cultivate courage by giving little doses of it. It's like this little, they say incremental change is effective change, right? Big giant jumps from 0 to 100 never get you anyplace. Same thing happens with courage. You can't be this meek, feeble, Knievel person, and then all of a sudden when life is on the line, like, I'm gonna be courageous. No, you're gonna be scared. Courage happens when you kind of give people these little tests and test their courage, and then you expand it out, and then you keep expanding it out. But you do have to have both. But we also want to teach that they aren't the same thing. Confidence isn't a lack of courage. Courage isn't just being overconfident, okay? Promises and challenges, capacity, yes. The last thing that I want to say at the 4 o'clock hour is five, I'm sorry. Sorry. Time is irrelevant right now, people. It's quarantine. I don't even know what day of the week it is. You always give me a heart. I was close and said four. I didn't say like noon. Anyway, laughter is amazing. But if you really want to get brain health down too, it's about being outside. If you can laugh in nature, if you can laugh under a tree based on the air, based on the nature, if your shoes are off and your feet are grounded on the earth, and then you laugh and you get into those belly laugh states, there's something magical that happens in our body that we cannot create anyplace else. That mental health thing, call it the mental health minute here at the end, is laugh, all those things, the brain science, you know, deal with trauma, diffuse situations, but at the same time, get outside and move. You can't be funny and you can't be a comedian if you're bitter and you're just like static. They say a half hour of movement creates 12 hours of healthy brain function. So get outside in nature, take a hike and allow your brain to operate and then allow you to be more funny, okay? But let's not get it twisted. Comedy doesn't make hopelessness better. Comedy is a tool to deal with some of those things that you're going to have to actively put effort and energy into making things different. Okay. My time is up. 5:05. I'm half Mexican, which means I'm right on time. Holla.
Hey, Jeremy, thank you so much for dropping that on us. I don't know if anybody else has it right now, but if your cheeks feel like my cheeks, I smiled so hard that I'm hurting a little bit here. Does anybody else have that? Can we give Jeremy a sign language round of applause, please, everybody.
Thank you.
And just that's
it. Part of it, Scott, and that's the whole idea is, you know, I thought about doing like a slide deck and making it very whatever, but it's like I'm trying to reinforce for you through this process, which is if you don't learn anything from here, then maybe this has been an hour for you to laugh, to smile, to get a little bit of a break. If you literally don't remember anything, just at least catch yourself and be like, do I feel better right now than I did when I got onto that call? And if you can say yes, it's not because I was good in the content. It's because you laughed and science took over. So just commit that to memory. This isn't about me being good. It's about you guys and your body taking over for you based on something that was in front of you.
You know, Jeremy, this is a very rare opportunity. You know, you're so successful and there's so many great things going on in your life and you put your priorities, you know, I think in place, which is time with your family, time with your children, time with your wife, hashtag time with your wife. I would love this opportunity for Ninja Dude or Corey or, you know, Amelia, you were so engaged in our last conversation. Would anybody like to just ask Jeremy anything that's on the top of their head? Or if you don't want to unmute yourself, go ahead and toss it in the chat over here. This is such a rare opportunity to engage with a brilliant mind. I'm going to shut up and let you go ahead and do that. So anybody that wants to take a couple seconds of Jeremy.
I see your note, Madison. Thank you. I appreciate you. Thanks for serving our country. Anything at all? Feel free to unmute and jump in there. Yes.
All right, bye, Serenity. You take care. I'll prompt you with something here, Jeremy. You know, we see that guitar sitting over there in the corner. That got me thinking about funny musicians and how impactful funny musicians are when they can combine music and comedy. And I think about Jack Black, and I think about his band Tenacious D. And not everybody knows that, but boy, oh boy, the combination of those two. Can you speak to me? Bo Burnham. Oh, yeah. Like, Bo Burnham wouldn't be who he is without that musical component. Can you talk a little bit about how maybe those two fit together for you?
Yeah, I mean, to me, like music and laughter, they're the best tools of engagement, like comedy and music, because they're so universal. Like, music speaks to everybody in certain ways, and it's for a lot of different reasons. There's a tribal sense, like, of just feeling music and what that brings out of us. But also, so many of us identify and connect with lyrics and songs. I was listening to a playlist today when I was getting all this stuff set up, that just by hearing the words that are then compounded with a melody, you can think about a song, it like has a feeling, and then they create some instrumentals and some like rhythm to communicate that feeling. And then they take a melody, which is like little bits of this and that, to communicate the story through the feeling, through the instrumentation. And if you're lucky enough, then they put lyrics on, which then go even deeper. And so for me, it's like this ultimate cake of goodness. I can make you feel a certain way through the music. I can communicate that feeling through different instrumentation. I can communicate it through a different melody by how much like room I leave things to marinate, or how quickly I want to get through lines. And then the same thing as the words that come in. And there are times that we can hear things when they're wrapped in music that we wouldn't hear them any other way. And again, it's one of those things that makes it acceptable somehow when we hear these songs. You know, I could think of, I was on a call last night, an international call, and they're like, what books have you read and all this stuff? Like, how do you know about Black culture and all this? And it's not just about growing up and traveling. A lot of everything I invest my time in has been about that. A lot of what I learned about Black culture was about being a kid that fell in love with breakdancing and hip hop and rap in 1983. And that was everything that I invested in. And so I was listening to not just Run DMC, but I was listening to Too Short and DJ Quick and people whose lyrics were ridiculously profane, but their truth, it allowed me to realize that my truth wasn't just my truth, that it was somebody else's too. And my job is to try and understand some of that. And so for me, whether it's comedy through music, I mean, Little Dicky is not a comedian, but so much of everything that he's doing is like, how do I make jokes to get people's attention, to then throw in these things that are these cultural issues that need to be addressed. That his show, you know, Dave on FX, I love watching it. My wife came down and she's like, what are you watching? Because it's vulgar, you know? And if you don't understand the context of this being his real life story as a white Jewish dude that's come up into the rap game and is not just there, but he's lyrically crushing it. Like, anybody that would acknowledge lyrics knows that this dude is next level. And so his ability to use comedy to then drive home these social issues that we need to be addressing, it's genius. And in a lot of ways, it's the only, I mean, you look at, and it's not just rap, you look at hardcore, like metal, you know, Scotty, some of the stuff that you listen to, it's that same mentality of like, how do I communicate this stuff and these feelings that I have, where if I say it without these power chords and double bass behind it, people are gonna look at me like I'm a freak. But if I can do it through some music, people are like, wow.
Well, Jeremy, that's what we have lined up for next week as well. Quick plug for our the next two people we have. Someone that Placer County Youth is familiar with is Raza, who is also a True Hope dealer, is going to be with us next week. He has some very powerful messages, turning pain into his passion, along with my homie Marcelo, MC Cello. They're going to be here next week. And they are going to pick up right with that message in, you know, discussing their art and how music has empowered them to reach others. So thank you for setting me up for that promo right there. And as people have to go ahead and tap out here, reminder, same bat channel next week at 4 o'clock to continue our Wellness Through Digital Connection series. Again, this is a recording that the Placer County Youth is going to have under CAP. So if you'd like to rewatch something or if you feel this is important, please reach out to them. And boy, you know what? You got me all excited to go watch some Bo Burnham later.
There's a new comedy special out. What's her name? Hannah. If you go on to Netflix, she's trending right now. She wrote the program, her one that was called like Lynette or Lalette or something. But she's autistic, a high-functioning autistic person that comes – I don't even know how to describe it. Her latest comedy special is genius in the way that she sets it up and is so witty and so fast and so quick with intelligent words that it's captivating. And if you have any, my son is on the spectrum, and I watched it with him, and he was like, I completely understand all of that. And it allowed me as a parent, even though he's 19 years old and I've been advocating for a long time, it was like, man, the way that she said that, I understood the way that your brain works. So if you get a chance, watch that. The other one I would always recommend is Neil Brennan's Two Mics. And that's this great special where he stands up and there's two microphones. One is him just doing one-liners, like just straight comedy, and then the lights go down, then he appears at the other mic, and it's all of his own personal stories about depression and everything. And so it's this idea about how he goes between these two places to give you just hard-hitting one-liners that are like comedically gold, and then goes over to the other mic and is vulnerable and shares his story. If you don't know about him, he was one of Dave Chappelle's, or is Dave Chappelle's best friend, helped write the Chappelle Show, was a writer for Comedy Central. He's real close with Jon Stewart and all that kind of stuff. So that's another one that I would always recommend to people. And it deals with depression, stardom, not feeling comfortable in your own skin, those kinds of things.
That's so cool. I wanted to jump in there and just say, hey, thank you, Jeremy, again for, gosh, every time we've had an opportunity to connect with you and have you bring your message and your special brand of the way you engage through music and now comedy. This is really kind of the first, you know, comedy spin that I've heard you.
The first time, literally.
Yeah, really? Okay. Well, it's awesome. And I love it. And it always just really, I mean, this is just perfect because the name of our retreat series is Wellness Through Connection. And that's what we're doing today. And just with all the chat, with all the engagement, I think that we're knocking it out of the park. You're knocking it out of the park. And just helping us create that engagement, you know, during this time of social distancing and everything else that's going on. And your message is always about hope and love. And yeah, so love it. And I'm taking notes here too, because my son is like, he wants to do stand-up comedy. He's like, he randomly says, Mom, I'm going to go to this amateur stand-up comedy night. I'm like, you are? And he's kind of a funny guy, but like, he's really into it. So I'm wishing I would have had him join today.
Well, you can show him the link, right?
What's that?
You can show him, send him the link, right?
Yeah, I could show him and send him the link. There we go. Yeah. That's a great reminder for everybody. If there's someone you think you wish would have been on today to hear this, there will be a replay link available. And we're going to share it on our YouTube page, and Renee's going to send it out to everybody. So you'll have access to that. And then lastly, you guys started to touch on it. Scott mentioned our next sessions coming up. Yeah, some super rad musicians, artists, performers, Jay Ross. Yep, I said rad again. I did, Scott.
I love when you say rad.
And then the last one of our series of sessions is Shani Jo Darden. And she happens to be my cousin, and she's like started this global movement around breast cancer prevention. Kind of the messaging is really geared towards younger people, and also the non-toxic revolution. So really that environmental kind of activism around environmental issues. And she's going to be on talking about how she created this global movement and became kind of a worldwide leader as a young artist. So I hope everybody joins for that those sessions as well.
Okay, you were saying, like, you're trying to give me thanks and praise, which I appreciate and I feel deeply. But at the same time, you took yourself out of that because you said we, and then you're like you. But it is you, and you're just. I appreciate you being people that are still advocating in and amongst all the crazy, which means we're taking on new things. This whole platform of trying to get people there when things have been planned, and then it's like, how do we reshift? You guys are amazing people doing amazing work, and it's the same thing when kids come up and they're like, "What you said to me changed my life," and I'm like, "That's great." But at the same time, I hope you give yourself a little bit of that credit too, which means you came in with an open mind and some open ears. Because if you came in closed, then no matter how good I am or whatever I say, it doesn't land. And so I could be that same person and be in my house, dad's food truck, which is amazing. But if you're not the people like you that are putting this whole thing on and still advocating for your community and trying to draw people in, especially when we need it most right now, is that I don't get to leverage my gifts either. So for as appreciative as I am of what you're saying to me, I just want to put it back on all of you and even the kids that came in here, which is like, good on you for being those people, young people that are still here, like to be done with school and to still jump on calls for self-growth and personal improvement. It's just an amazing thing. So thank you for being thankful for me, but thank you for being those people as well.
You know, Jeremy, one of the challenges of hosting on this type of platform is you don't get to hear the applause. You don't get to hear the, you know, the chuckles or the laughs and the challenges there. So I find that after the, I'm sure Jessica, I'm sure you've experienced this at school, and Michaela and Serena and some of the other names that I see up here. What I picture is you inside your space where you're comfortable with your smells and with, you know, kind of your stuff around you. And now this call is going to end. And there's going to be this vacuum where you take something that you heard or learned or an emotion or a feeling, and then you put that into the space that you're at. Zach and his whole crew, we don't even know how many people are with him right now. The challenge that we have for you all is to take something that happened on a screen from all different corners of the United States. You know, we have people halfway across the United States here. Is to take it and do something with it. And Jeremy, why don't I let you go ahead and speak towards the difference between knowledge and power.
That wasn't on the agenda, Scotty.
I know, bro, but you're so good at talking about that.
No, it's just, you know, it's the idea of, one of my favorite quotes says, experience isn't what happens to us, it's what we do with what happens to us. And so by being a part of this call, nothing changes for you. By sitting and listening, nothing changes. By being an app, maybe, like, that's my fear in a lot of everything that's happening right now, and the momentum and the knowledge that people are kind of getting and the images that they're seeing. It's like, great, well, now you're aware, and so now what? And that's really the differentiator between people that are getting by and people that become next level and whatever it is they want to do. All the information is there. This is not a knowledge game. And that's when you look at people in certain fields, like, the hard skills can all be learned, and it's always the differentiator of what kind of bit of your sauce do you put onto those skills, and most specifically, how much of those skills are you implementing every day in your choices, and how intentful are you making sure that what you know is being included in what it is that you're doing, that there's congruency between the things that you know and the things that you say are important to you and the things that you're actually doing. And the closer that you can get all those things, the better off that you're going to be. Or the other way to look at it is, when you know a lot about something and you're not doing anything about it, the further distance that's created between those two things is the more dysfunction that you have in those two things. I know what it takes to be a good husband. I don't do that every day. The further these two things get away, the more dysfunction will be in my life when it comes to my relationship. The closer that I could put those two things, the more successful I'm going to be as a husband and as a dad that's going to be married to my wife forever. Or a husband that we married to our wife together for my kids, so they can see what a dad looks like. Does that make sense?
To me,
it wasn't on the script, so, you know.
Well, anybody, we got a couple more minutes. I'm going to cut us off right at 5:30. So if you'd like to engage with Jeremy or any of us, really.
Well, first, I'll just say, Christina, thank you for your kind words about being at the wall at Richardson Springs. I was going to come make a joke because it's like 84 degrees here on the coast, 2 miles from the beach. And I was like, oh, my God, it's so hot. You guys know what it's like. And so my time at Richardson Spring on the wall always kind of reminds me of that, you know, which is just being out there at 110 degrees and trying to get people to be excited about saving people's lives. And I guess there's probably a metaphor in that right now, because I feel like we're in a culture that's burning at 150 degrees and we still need to be focused on saving people's lives. So thank you, Christina, for acknowledging that. And thank you, Joanna, too, for the comment about manhood. Appreciate it, but it's, I don't know, it's all good. But thank you for being amazing people. I appreciate you wanting to listen to me for an hour. And Scott, I will say, just another funny joke, not really a joke, but true life. The very first one of these I did a couple weeks ago, I got done and it was live and there was 100-something people on it. And I felt like I did well, but I kind of walked from, this is my garage that I've had to redo into a whole studio. And so when I walk in through my garage door, I'm in the house. And I didn't know how to feel when I was done with it. Like, it was just like, and I remember my body didn't feel right. And my wife, I would just like sit on the couch in silence. And she's like, what is wrong with you? And I'm like, I don't know. Like, first of all, what you're seeing right now is me on a 6-hour car ride or an 8-hour flight when I'm done with the program. I literally put headphones on without music and just noise cancel. And I go over every line, everything I said, what I wanted to say versus what I didn't. I probably should have drove that point home. And I'm just going through it all. And so the first part of it was she's getting to see that process because now I'm not on a plane or in a car. I'm in my living room. And then the other weird part about it is kind of what you're getting to, Scott, as a speaker, when I can't feel this, like I can see some of you, I can't even see all of you. And some of you are on a delay. So when you're laughing, it's like, you know, I'm like, are they laughing or are they having a seizure? You know, do I want to show you my life-saving skills with that? It's that part's hard, but then even more so, I do this because I want to be good for people. And it's not just to feel good about myself and the content I can create. And so after programs, when I have lines of people that are sitting around that want to talk and tell me those things, it's a chance for me to really feel what was expressed from their side and what they got. And this text is great. People are saying great things, but I know people can lie from a keyboard. I'm not sure if you're aware of that. The other thing that we learn about text is there's no tone in text. And so somebody could be like, you're good, Jeremy. And I could read that in my head and be like, oh, you're really good, Jeremy. So it's a weird dynamic to be a speaker in this world when so much of what I do is about making sure that I was good enough for people. And when the people aren't there and you don't get to feel that, then I'm just sitting in my living room for like 10 hours being like, shit, I don't even know if that was, I don't know. And my wife's like, you got to be different about this. So I've been getting better. But I definitely felt that when this whole idea of like when you don't have that connection and you can't see people. And like I said, this isn't about time, wasting time or creating content. It's about, hey, can I give you something good? And did you feel it? And I can tell that people based on their actions and the things they say when they say it. One of the coolest things my dad taught me is you can snow the snowman, but you can't bullshit the bullshitter.
Mm-hmm. You know what my dad taught me?
I can't never did shit.
I know. Yeah, he said that. My dad said, what do you call a bear with no teeth? A gummy bear. I saw Jessica's face move. She's not frozen.
Time to unmute everybody so they can hear some love from us. Some laughing. It's got to be tough not hearing voices.
I want to hear a couple more really good bad jokes to wrap this up today. I'm kind of looking to put them in my book.
I leave the bad jokes to my husband.
I got a stand-up routine, but I'm not doing that now.
Omni Youth Programs, we're so happy you guys are joining. Remind me where you guys are from.
Sacramento.
Oh, okay. You're muted. Oh, you're muted. We couldn't hear you, but that's okay.
Oh, it's me. I thought you guys are muting me, but I was muting myself. Yeah, we're from Sacramento. We do marijuana and alcohol prevention for young people. And I do have a couple dad jokes.
Okay.
I know you're waiting. Okay. What type of animal do you not want to play poker with? A cheetah. Okay, one more. This is my daughter's favorite. How do you make a tissue dance?
You put a
little boogie in it. Everybody with the 3-year-old knows
that. On Comedy Friends.
I love it. Scott, do that one. I just have one more quick one.
Okay.
What is a pirate's favorite letter?
R.
You think it was R, but they love the C.
That's a really good reminder not to ruin other people's jokes when you know a punchline, right?
No, it's fun when you know it, but yeah.
Nobody wants to be that guy.
You got a bonus joke then, so there you go.
All right, cool.
Thanks, it was wonderful. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Jessica, I know you're itching to tell us your best joke.
I always mix up a lot of them, but let's see. Okay, what do you call a conductor with anger issues? What do you call a conductor with anger issues? No. What do you call it when a conductor, I don't know, what do you call it when a conductor gets mad, I guess? A tempo tantrum.
Ah!
Sorry, I couldn't remember
how
to phrase that.
Pretty good. Yeah.
The band geek in me loves that one. I was going to say, call him Bob Sando, who was my high school music conductor, but.
Can I say one more?
Yeah.
What did the egg say to the fork? You crack me up.
Nice.
I feel like this is a whole separate Zoom call where we're all just like,
No. I have a question for everybody. Does anybody use Fitbits or check their walking steps during the day, you know? Does everybody always trying to get their steps in?
Yes.
So isn't it funny how even though we try to get our steps in every day, every time we park somewhere, we try to get to the closest parking spot to the door?
Yeah.
I see what you're saying.
Not funny, but it's funny.
Jeremy, that's a
it's
Jeremy
ironic,
song.
Ironic, not funny.
Style joke.
It's an observation, though. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's good. They're all good.
That's all right. I will go to another career.
All right, party animals. Thank you so much for your time and for your engagement. And again, thank you for your time. We can't get these this hour and a half back. Jeremy, thank you so much for your time and for your heart. I see over on the side here, we felt that. So thank you so much. Now off into the void, everyone. Carry these messages forward. Same bat time, same bat channel next week. And Jeremy, is there anything else you'd like to say before we end our call?
Thank you. My heart, my soul, I appreciate you all. Thank you so much for having me be part of what you're doing.
Woo-hoo. Thank you.
Be well, everyone. Take care of yourselves.
Thanks, Jeremy.
And we'll see you soon.
Thank you, Scott. Great job.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Oh, there's Alyssa's face.
Jeremy, much love for you and all you do.
Shelly.
All right, everybody, get out of here so I can talk to Jeremy.
Okay. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Take care.